Small dams like these aren't practical for the people of New Delhi. They couldn't provide enough water. Experts say that in New Delhi, water conservation and new water supplies could make life better for about 10 years. But the work of Rajendra Singh in Alwar shows that change is possible. Now, the people there don't have to walk many miles for water. Clean, fresh water is always close by. His success shows that the people in different places need to find the solution that is right for them.
Janigul Farah is in front of a group of people. He's blindfolded, but he can still show them something that's amazing. The young Italian man calls it the art of memory. First, the people randomly choose 60 numbers. After that, a helper reads the numbers to Johnny. Then Johnny repeats the numbers in the correct order from memory. First in the order he heard them, then again, backwards.
Si chiama memoria.
It's a kind of memory that is connected to what I see. It means that every idea I learn, everything I read, becomes a part of me. Normally, a person who doesn't have this gift and who hasn't studied memory tends to just forget things, even an entire book. Not me.
Johnny has a special kind of memory. He has memorized more than 250 books. He also says that he can remember every detail of every day of this life from the time he was less than 1 year old. Memory is very difficult to understand, and scientists don't really know how it works. The Gulfera family genes may hold important information about Johnny's memory. Neurobiologist Dr. Antonio Malgaroli plans to compare the Gulfera's family's genes with the genes of more forgetful families.
The crucial question is to understand which is the contribution from heredity and which is the contribution that comes from the environment.
When we process new information, such as reading a book or newspaper, it goes into our brains through the hippocampus. There, it's coded as memory. But how is memory coded? Where is it stored? Why is it stored there? Nobody knows. Nobody knows why some people lose their memories or why so few people, like Johnny, never forget things. Researchers are now studying how memory and learning change the brain. They're also trying to match those changes to specific genes. Some research shows that a great memory may not depend on the right DNA.
If you really need to use your brain capacity to store some kind of information, you have this ability, and you know, it's just a matter of exercise.
The same idea is true for Johnny. His genes are only part of the story. Since the age of 11, he's been training his brain to remember. He practices continuously to improve the power of his memory. He has even memorized a whole series of historical books. For Johnny, improving his memory has become almost like a full-time job.
Gulfera has an extraordinary ability. The question is, you know, how much it's really because of, you know, the Gulfera family genes, and how much comes from his sort of, you know, maniac type of activity.
Johnny's life is not all about science, though. He has a relatively normal life. He has a dog and a girlfriend. He likes to take time away from work. In other words, he's just like other people. And that's part of what's so interesting. His genes are partly responsible for his great memory. However, researchers think it's mainly because of his very hard work, and Johnny agrees. He even offers proof. He holds classes to teach people how to improve their memories. His system involves organization and hard work. Basically, learning how to remember to remember.
I think the only problem with memory is getting the correct order. There's a lot of brain space, so I think there are no limits.
If there is a memory gene, Johnny Gulfera probably has it. But the success of The Memory Man may be more about determination than DNA. Johnny's practice and hard work are making his memory even better. He might just be showing scientists that a great memory can be made and not just born.
Let's travel to Mexico now, to the historic state of Oaxaca. It's a place that's famous for its traditions and its food. If you feel cold in winter, you can warm up in Oaxaca by enjoying its spicy chilies, its beautiful dances, and its lovely streets and buildings. When you come to Oaxaca, beautiful colors and wonderful smells are all around you. Oaxaca is one of the poorest states in Mexico, but it's rich in culture, and Oaxacan food is famous around the world.
It's one of the best foods. It's very complex.
Susanna Trilling loves the chilies in Oaxacan food. She moved here 14 years ago to start her own cooking school. Many foreigners have come to learn how to make real Oaxacan mole and other dishes. Susanna's students heard about Oaxacan food in their own countries, and they come here wanting to learn more. People stay in Oaxaca and take cooking classes at the school. Oaxacan food developed a long time before people came from Europe to America. Tradition is keeping this food alive, and Susanna thinks Oaxacan food is as interesting and difficult to make as Thai food or French food. It uses many different ingredients. The first step in cooking Oaxacan food is making a sauce called mole. Mole is made from chili peppers, spices, and various other ingredients. Mole is standard in many different Oaxacan dishes. People serve it with chicken and meat and everything else. But Oaxacan culture is more than just food. The state is also famous for its dances. This dance is centuries old. It's called the Guelaguetza. It tells about the culture, history, and music of the Oaxacan people. The buildings in the city are large and beautiful. Many of them are Mexican national treasures. This building is 500 years old, with fountains, gardens, and archways. In the past, it was a government building. Today, it's a luxury hotel. Oaxacan people say that a healthy person is happy and loves to work and eat. After a short visit to Oaxaca, you can see that that tradition is still true.
Millions of years ago, man's earliest ancestors lived in a far region of Ethiopia. In this area, hot lava has erupted from the Urta-Ala volcano for about 100 years. The temperature of this lava is more than 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, a team of explorers is going to see Urta-Ala for themselves. They want to learn more about the volcano. It's not an easy trek, and the team has to use camels. They finally reach the crater. Frank Tessier and Irene Margaritas are geologists and professors at the University of Nice. They've traveled halfway around the world to see Urta-Ala. Deep in the crater, they see the black lava lake.
It's quite exciting. I want to see it now.
Urta-Ala is in the Afar area of Ethiopia. The Afar Triangle is in an area where three continental plates meet. These plates move farther apart every year. The Urta-Ala volcano has the oldest lava lake in the world. The lake is also one of the lowest points on Earth. At Urta-Ala, geologists study how the world started millions of years ago. Red-hot lava comes out from deep in the Earth. This lava forms Urta-Ala's lava lake. As the lava cools down, it becomes hard and black. Hot magma breaks through this covering as the volcano erupts. The geologists stand at the top of the active volcano and wait at the side of the crater. It's not easy to be there. There is a strong smell of sulfur. Even in the early morning, it's very, very hot. Then the group goes down into the crater. Professor Tessier wants to collect samples of the red-hot lava. It's 2 o'clock in the morning before they return. They're very tired, and as Professor Margarita says,
very hot.
I think this is fresh lava.
The pieces didn't come directly from the lava lake. However, the team decides they're fresh enough. The team will now go back to analyze the samples. As professors, they want to learn new information that they can teach to others. However, as geologists, they want to know what the lava of Irta'ala may teach them about how the world began millions of years ago.
This beautiful, quiet place is covered in sunshine and has mountains all around it. Its name is Machu Picchu. It's sometimes called the Lost City of the Incas, and it's nearly 8,000 feet up in the Andes.
It's a magic attraction that you can feel it here. It's known all over the world that Machu Picchu is one of the magnetic centers of the ancient world.
Machu Picchu is more than 500 years old. Today, it's a favorite place for visitors from all over the world. Even in the rain and fog, it's wonderful to walk through the ruins. When the Inca civilization ended, few people knew Machu Picchu existed. For a long time, it was lost to the outside world. Then, in 1911, an explorer named Hiram Bingham found it again. At first, very few people visited Machu Picchu, but now hundreds of tourists come here every day. They walk up the steps of the ancient city and climb over the ruins. Machu Picchu is no longer quiet. It's full of the sounds of tourists. Some people in Peru hope that more tourists will come here. They think it will mean more business and money for the country. However, some conservationists worry that more visitors won't be good for Machu Picchu. They say that tourism might not be good for the environment. Jose, a local hotel owner, says Machu Picchu and Peru can take a few more visitors.
Why not be like the rest of the world? Why not expose and show Machu Picchu to the rest of the world? It's such a wonderful place that why keep it to the few?
The truth is that parts of Peru are very poor, and tourists bring money to these communities. Aguas Calientes is a town that grew suddenly near an area where visitors get on buses to get to the summit of Machu Picchu. The people here live completely on money from tourism. The town is just a group of stalls where local people sell art and things they have made to visitors. The lost city is no longer lost. Tourists have found it. The modern world is coming closer to this ancient world every day. Time may be running out for the lost city of the Incas. More and more people are discovering it. In the end, it may be the modern world that forever changes this ancient city.
It's September in the Congo, just north of the equator. An expedition unlike any other is beginning. A team of scientists and researchers is traveling nearly 1,200 miles or 2,000 kilometers through a rainforest that covers almost 58,000 square miles or 150,000 square kilometers. Their aim is to make a scientific record of a world that could be disappearing from Earth, the Congo Basin. Dr. Michael Fay is a scientist from the Wildlife Conservation Society. He's leading the expedition he calls the Mega Transect, or the Big Crossing. According to Fay, if they don't document the wildlife here now, there may never be another chance to do it.
What I'm trying to do in a desperate way is to show the world that we're just about to lose the last little gem in the African continent. And if we don't do something now, if we don't do it today, we can forget about it.
The Congo Basin contains almost one quarter of the world's rainforests. It may have up to half of all of the wild plants and animals found in all of Africa. Fay's plan is to collect and record data on almost every part of the rainforest. He wants to document the trees, the plants, and the animals that he sees there. It's a job that's going to take time. After 8 months of traveling, the team is now in Gabon. Their next challenge is to reach a group of strange hills that are made of stone and which rise far above the forest floor. At last, the men reach the hills and begin to walk up. Suddenly, they realize that they're finally above the tops of the trees.
You can see a long way here, you know, 70 or 80 kilometers in every direction, and we can see 360 degrees around. There are no humans. There's not a single village. There's not a single road. It's an amazing place.
The team continues. They can hear their next challenge before they reach it. Rapids.
Okay, wow.
The Congo chutes are an important part of the landscape that the team wants to protect. This land of fast water and old forests is in danger because of logging. Right now, the team has a more immediate problem. They must cross the dangerous river here. It's only a few hundred meters wide, but the team must use guide ropes, stepping stones, and everything they know to get across. It takes a full day, and there's still a long way to go. After more than a year, the team finally reaches the end of their travels.
We'd been walking in the woods in our own little world for 15 months, and now it was over.
Dr. Fay's expedition walked through some of the wildest lands of Africa. They documented as many of the things they found as possible, and they did it all in an attempt to save a disappearing world.
The souk in the city of Fez is Morocco's oldest market. In one of its small stalls, a craftsman is making patterns on a metal tabletop. But all around him, people are making deals. This is business, Moroccan style. Sales in the souk happen face to face. It's very personal and very busy. The vendors have everything a shopper could want. Sandals are next to fish bowls, and nearby, birds in cages watch the scene. One vendor sells caftans, others sell slippers or jewelry. Across the alley, a man sells dates and apricots to hungry shoppers. In the souk, there really is something for everyone, and in the city of Fez, a certain kind of small red hat is very easy to find. The Fez was created here and named after the city. A visit to the souk is a lesson in Moroccan bargaining culture. For visitors, the question is not, what should I buy, but how should I buy it? That's where they get a real education in making a deal.
You have to start yourself at one-third or something, and then you bargain up to 50%.
And they go down at twice as hard as we go up with the price.
Yeah.
So then you get at half the price they say at first.
But it's really a game. The Moroccans are very good at bargaining, and they say they are the best in the world.
You know, here in Moroccan cultures, for everything you should bargain. We don't have really fixed price.
In the souk, shopping is an exercise in bargaining. Here, it's the natural thing to do, and just about everyone does it. However, visitors who want to practice making a deal here had better be careful. They ought to know a few things first. Beginners at bargaining pay more. How much more?
Sometimes 20, 30% more, over, than the price what Moroccan people pay. So you should always bargain. If you charge 1,000 dirham, you give him 600 dirham, then you go up, he go down, and then you can arrange between you.
Vendors aren't trying to cheat customers. It's like a test to find out who's the best bargainer.
Some customers pay more than one another one. We find more easy, they don't bargain too much.
The real test for any bargainer is the carpet shop. This is where the sellers really pressure customers to buy something.
No, excuse me, do you want to buy a camel for the price of donkey? Impossible. No, that's too low, believe me, that's too low.
Once you end up in a shop, you sat there drinking tea and you say, I don't want to buy anything, but then it's like, well, just offer a price, you know, 500, what's your best price? And you're like, I don't want to buy it. And they're like, okay, 300.
But it's all part of the game.
Well, we ask a little bit a high price because everyone comes with an intention to bargain. They know that in Morocco they bargain a lot. So, of course, we leave a step to make discounts and haggling the price.
Some shoppers enjoy the challenge too.
The secret is looking very careful at how they look and watch them, how they move. Yeah, and then go step by step and see where you end.
There is one thing that all tourists should watch out for. They shouldn't buy too much.
The thing is, they make it so cheap for you. Well, they start up so high and the end it sounds so cheap, you know, and it's only 1/6 of the price or 1/8 of the price. Well, for this money, I can't leave it.
For some visitors to Fez, it may be difficult to leave without buying more than they planned. One thing here is certain. At the souk, everyone can make a deal.